Welcome. Actually, welcome back, Jack. We're today on the 20th day of the month, holy month of Shvat, 5777. Title, drumroll. Title of today's Shiur, today's class, will be the expulsion of Jews from Amona. Warning graphic. It's a long title, but that's it. Okay, last week around this time, I was not able to be at this class as I was in the holy city of Amona fighting against the expulsion of Jews by Jews. We'll see later if it's actually by Jews or people in Israel expelling the Jews in Amona. And there are many, many points that you might have heard, but I'm sure that in our lesson, with God's help, there will be many, many points you will not hear anywhere else, and you could take that one to the bank. Okay, I have to see, amazing fact is that there were two expulsions from the holy city of Amona. The first one took place 11 years ago, and the most recent, second one, took place 2 weeks ago. Now, believe it or not, they both occurred at the same date. And as we know, there's nothing as chance in life, in the world, in the Torah. Both expulsions, even though 11 years apart, are fell at the same time. The beginning, to be exact, the fifth day of the month of Shvat. And as we know, or we should know by this time, anybody that follows the classes here, we know that just like if you study the portion of the week, you'll see the events of the week hinted within the portion of the week, because the Torah is eternal, and it wasn't just for, you know, back then or once upon a time. It's for every single generation, it's for every single day. It's for the future, it's for the past, is, was, will be. So therefore also, if we know if something occurs in a month, there are certain energies, certain spiritual energies that are prevalent during every month, some better, some worse. So we have to look first, what does the month of Shvat, these two expulsions took place in this month, what is the spirituality of these months? Why are Jews being uprooted? Now we know we have a thumb of rule in the Torah. Thumb of rule is Zelu Matze Asai Elokim. For every light that exists, there is a force of darkness to combat that. Anything good you have in the world, you will have the flip side of the coin, will be the opposite. For example, the Maharal says a very interesting point. The Maharal says that who is the flip side of the coin for Moshe and Aaron, Moses and Aaron? Okay, hold on to your seats, put on a seatbelt. Their opposites were the notorious, the dynamic or not so dynamic duo, Datan ve'Aviram. If you look in the Torah, there's always some kind of, there's a dispute. There's a major battle royal happening between Moses and Aaron and Datan v'Aviram. I mean, just to give an example, one or two examples, the first time we meet, Moses meets up with Datan and Aviram, they're having a fight amongst themselves, Moses comes and rebukes them, and they have a battle royal, where eventually Datan and Aviram, they go and they tell the king Pharaoh about what Moses did the previous day to the Egyptian. Number two, we have a battle royal when the Jews are no longer given straw for the making of the bricks. We have once again a battle royal, Moses, Aaron coming against Datan ve'Aviram. You'll see that five or six times. But I gave you two examples, we'll hold on that. So that's the concept. Ze lumat ze asa Elokim. For every great soul, you'll have the opposite. Trying to defeat the counterpart. So we know that if this is a month of destruction, there must be an opposite side of this month of building. And let's look into this. Okay. Our first source here is from the book Moed Kol Chai of Rav Chaim Falaji. This is in the 29th chapter, third paragraph. Listen closely. The month of Shvat is a very difficult month, and it is connected spiritually to the month of Av. Now that is a grand slam statement here. We know that the biggest atrocities against the Jewish people, against the temple, have always taken place in the month of Av. We could stay here and give a class or two on the tragedies, if it's the expulsion from Spain, if it's World War I, if it's the destruction of the both temples, and the list goes on and on and on. So the archetype bad month of the Jewish people is, of course, the month of Av. That is a time where we're in a period of mourning, not like as in good mourning, but OU mourning. So Rav Chaim Falaji tells us an unbelievable statement here. The partner of the month of Av is no unbelievable, is a surprise to maybe many. The month of Shvat. So there's a connection. So when we talk about the destruction of the Jewish people, when we talk about the destruction of the temple, destruction of holiness, so understand that just like this happens, it occurs in the month of Av, which is approximately July, August, depending on which year. So here, now we're talking about approximately January, February time, the month of Shvat is connected to destruction. In fact, if you notice, both months, the month of Av and the month of Shvat, they both have a holiday on the same date. In Shvat, there's a holiday, it's called Tu B'Shvat, the 15th day of Shvat. It's a happy day for the Jewish people. In the month of Av, after the destruction, we get up from the mourning, we get up from destruction, and we have a tremendous celebration. There were never such great days for the Jewish people, such as Yom Kippur and the 15th day of Av. So very interesting, these 2 months, which are connected spiritually. On one hand, they're connected destruction. On the other hand, they both have some of the greatest holidays right in the middle, on the 15th. And there's a lot of connection between these two holidays. for another class. Rav Falaji goes on, and listen to what he says. In the month of Shvat, in this month that we're in, it is good for a Jew to set aside a time every day to pray to Hashem, to beseech Hashem, that He will save us, and He will save our household, and He will save the Jewish people from all atrocities. An amazing thing. Where else do we see this? In the month of Av and the month of Shvat, Rav Chaim Falaji says, set time aside. Sit down. Plead to Hashem. Save us from calamity. Amazing. If you think about it, when was Gush Katif destroyed and the settlements in the Gaza Strip 11 years ago? When did this take place? It took place in the month of Av. There's a funny story to this, ha ha ha, if you know, it's kind of like humor, sort of. Anyways, originally the government set the expulsion and the destruction day of Gush Katif to be the 17th day of Tammuz. Because they go according to the Gentile calendar, so that was fine for them. But then somebody noticed that it turns out to be a fast day. Turned out to be the 17th day of Tammuz, which is a fast day, which opens up the period of 3 weeks, which connects us to the 9th day of the month of Av, which is a bad time for the Jewish people, those 3 week mourning period. So therefore they switched it. When did they switch it? They switched it to like a day or two after the fast of Av. So we see an unbelievable Amona. Amona was destroyed two times, 11-year span, in the month of Shvat. The brother or the sister month of Shvat is Av, as we're told by Rav Chaim Falaji. And there was the destruction, a great destruction, of 26 communities in the Gaza Strip. He goes on, Rav Chaim Falaji says, it's very important to be careful during this month of Shvat. Be careful. Do not open yourself up to, cases, to events that might be dangerous, which means that it's a dangerous time of the year. So you don't want to open up yourself to all kinds of moves that perhaps are some kind of risk involved in them. It might be also financially. Don't take risks. However, on the 15th day of the month of Shvat, just like in the 15th day of the month of Av, all of this switches around. All of this switches around, and the time becomes the good time. Yeah, it becomes the good times. From the 15th day on, this becomes times of mercy, times of joy for the Jewish people. Now, it's very interesting. As we know, the Arizal taught us that every new month, when we have the special prayer, the special additional Musaf prayer for the new month, we say a blessing over the new month, and you are supposed to have in mind the special name of God that presides during this month. Every single month has a different order of the name of God, and those attributes exist, run that month. Anything could be changed, as we know that the Jewish people can change, even if they have a certain luck, certain mazal, as we call it. We could still change that with our deeds, with our Torah, with our actions. But every single month, depending on how the name of God is written, there are many names, 72 names of God, depending on God's name being written, that is what kind of spiritual energy is in that month. So very interesting, in these 2 months of Shvat and Av, in the first two letters, which means the first half of the month, because there's 4 letters to God's name. So 4 letters, 4 weeks. If you take the first 2 letters, it's it's connected to the first 2 weeks of the month. So the first two letters of God's name are backwards. When things are backwards, you know, that means strict judgment. That's not good times. The third and fourth letter of God's name in both these months, Shvat and Av, are according to order. According to order, this is times of kindness, times of mercy. So, very interesting, spiritually speaking. Keep that in mind. Okay, now, very interesting, besides this point, Rav Chaim Falaji goes on, and it says this month is connected to a spiritual level called Hod, glory. These are one of the Sfirot, where the world was created. So one of them is called Hod. And it says the following. As we know, the spiritual father of the sphere of Hod, glory, is of course the priest Aaron. And Aaron, what he exceeded in especially was love of Israel. So therefore he says in this month more than other months, be careful when it comes dealing with your fellow Jew, try to be a conductor of a person that brings peace and harmony to people instead of friction and argument. So this is a special month, he says, because it's the month is connected to Aaron the priest, Aaron HaKohen, that if, therefore a person has to be careful. Now, if this is so, the opposite side of the coin would be infighting between the Jewish people. So on one hand, this month is special to bring peace and harmony amongst Jewish people. However, we said everything in the world, there's the contra, the opposite. And so therefore, there's going to be a lot of forces out there that are going to try to create strife between the Jewish people. Okay, moving right along. The Zohar Kadosh says in Midrash Eicha, it's called Zohar Chadash, it's page 184, says the following. Listen closely. It says that there are good times for the Jewish people and there are times of judgment, difficult times for the Jewish people. When are the good times for the Jewish people? Says the following. There are four special months that there are tremendous amount of blessing, light for the Jewish people, tremendous amount of miracles that happen during these months. They are the following, and they happen in a sequence. They are the month of Adar, we have Purim, we have the month of Nisan, which of course is Passover, we have Iyar, which is the second Passover, and we have Sivan, which is the receiving of the Torah. These are four great months that were given to the Jewish people. On the other hand, the opposite side, we have months that are difficult, dark times for the Jewish people. Which are they? They are the following. They are the month of Tammuz, July, Av, August, Tevet and Shvat is January and February. These are the difficult. So think about it. We have four great months, and as we said, everything in the world has to have some kind of opposite. We said Moses and Aaron, their opposites were Datan ve'Aviram. And we have the first part of the months of Shvat and Av are terrible. And on the other hand, we have a great time. From the 15th day to the end of those months, the exact opposite. So that's how, if you think about it, when a person wants to strengthen his body, so what do we do? Everything is going against when we work out, so we're working against the gravity. We're trying to push ourselves, and this is doing the exact, it's like the contra of, that's how a person builds their strength. So the same thing too, Hashem gives us a test, puts the, for every light, there's some kind of darkness trying to flicker out that light. So we have to be aware of that. Okay, moving right along about the special month of Shvat. Listen to this. There's a book, it's called Davar Bitot, written by Rav Yoel Schwartz. It says a beautiful thing. He brings down the Chida. The Chida says that the word, the two words, Eretz Yisrael, the land of Israel, the Chida brings down that the numerical value of the land of Israel is the exact numerical value, okay, of Tet Lev, to, for a person to examine, to keep his eyes open, to be aware of. So he says, the Chida, that why is it the same numerical value? That a person, in order to appreciate the land of Israel, the holiness, the spirituality of it, the specialness, the beauty, if you want to, you have to open up your eyes. Because if you don't make an effort, you might not see it. So, this is an amazing thing, that in order to appreciate Eretz Yisrael, it is the numerical value of, you have to, your heart has to be connected, you have to investigate, you have to open up your eyes, your ears, and your heart, and investigate, and then you'll see the beauty of the land of Israel. And then he goes on, and he says an amazing thing, Rav Schwartz, that the Satmar Rebbe, the Satmar Rebbe says, there's a verse in Jeremiah 9, and he asked the question, the prophet asked the question, why was the land destroyed? Alma avda haaretz, why was the land destroyed? And the answer that the Talmud gives, al azvam et torati, because the Jewish people left the Torah. So the Satmar Rebbe takes this statement via Jeremiah the prophet and the Talmud, and he says, let's look at this. And the Satmar Rebbe says, why have the people in Israel, why have they stopped calling it, why have they stopped calling Israel the land of Israel? Instead, it has become only the state of Israel. What happened to the land of Israel? And his answer is based on this question of Jeremiah. Jeremiah, 2,500 or so years ago, more than that, he looks out and he asks the question, why has the land been destroyed? You know why? So the Satmar Rebbe plays on this verse, a beautiful, eye-opening thought. He says, you know why we lost the word Eretz, land? Why? Al azvam Torati, when a Jew becomes disconnected from the Torah, therefore he becomes disconnected, he becomes disconnected to the land. He becomes disconnected to the land. Friend of mine, I had a guest over on Shabbos, actually a friend of my son, told me that that his grandparents, they own many, many orchards, fruit trees in the area of what they like to call the center of Israel, Petach Tikva, Tel Aviv, Rosh Ha'ayin, in those areas. And I said, well, what is he doing? Does he, you know, is that his job? Do they deal with that kind of work? He says, not at all. They don't deal with it at all. They're just looking right now to get rid of it, and so they could build high rises over there. That's what they're looking for. What happened to the land? What happened to the dream? It's gone. Let's build those high risers, you know? So the Satmar Rebbe says an unbelievable Torah. How did we become disconnected to the land of Israel? When we left the Torah. I'll add, Rav Kook has an unbelievable take. Rav Kook, Avram Yitzchak Kook, 100 years ago, he writes the following. He writes about the Zionist movement, that if they do not connect themselves to the Torah, their love of the land of Israel will turn into a monster of hate against the land of Israel. He wrote that 100 years ago when he saw the roots of the Zionist movement. If they will not connect themselves to Torah, then the love of the land of Israel will turn into despising the land of Israel. A monster, that's his words. It will turn into a monster. And Rav Schwartz goes on. He goes on and he says, think about it. What is the month of Av? Right, we have the big holiday of Tu B'Shvat. What is Tu B'Shvat? Tu B'Shvat, we said the land of Israel. If you don't study, if you're not connected, if you don't open your heart, your eyes, gain your ears to understand what's special about this place, the land of Israel. If you don't do that, you're going to miss the points. You're going to miss out over here. So, he says it unbelievable. He says, this month, the half point of this month, it symbolizes love of the land of Israel all over the world. During the month of Shvat that we're in right now, people buy fruits from the land of Israel and they have a special seder. There's a special meal in the evening or during the day and they say special blessings and they talk about the land of Israel and they speak about prophecies of the land of Israel, speak Torah about the land of Israel. So think about this. He says it's unbelievable. In this month, which represents love of the land of Israel more than any other month, which is also interesting because we know, as we said 10 minutes ago, the sister, the brother, the twin of this month of Shvat is the month of Av, and that is when the spies said, let's not go into the land of Israel. It was during the month of Av. So very interesting. We have the same thing. It's a month that God wanted to bring us into the land of Israel. And it turned out the opposite of this. It turns out to be a destruction. It turned out to be that we would have to wait 40 years to come into the land of Israel. So you have this battle royal going on. Good, evil. So we have here, listen to what Rav Yoel Schwartz notices. Rav Yoel Schwartz wrote this 6 years ago. Listen to what he writes. He says, we see that because of the fact that people become disattached with the Torah, therefore the love of the land of Israel has turned into the hate of the land of Israel. Where do we see this? Heres habatim bikfar Amona beachzariut raba kara karov letu bishvat zemil amer al itnatkut me'aretz. Explaining, translating, he says an unbelievable point. He understood the point that Amona took place where the people were expelled cruelly. During this time of year, 11 years ago, this is the first time. Okay, I'm sure he's going to write again. I'm sure he's going to notice again that it happened again 11 years later. Same date, same month, which represents the month that represents the love of the land of Israel. It's turned into the hate of the land of Israel. Just like these 2 months, Av and Shvat, have turned into hate against the land of Israel. Amona. The name Amona. Even though we have a little bit of a joke, the times that I've been there in the last month or so, I have various friends that give me calls when there's suspicion that the forces of evil are going to come and destroy Amona. So I get calls, so occasionally when I'm able to, so I travel and I try to get myself in there. So sometimes it's, you know, the middle of the night, sometimes morning, sometimes afternoon. But I've spent 5 or 6 days in Amona recently. And the joke is we call it ammonia. If you've been there, you know, you're in the, it's like really cold up there. It's about 900 meters above sea level, 900 to 1,000 meters above sea level. It's like a lot of mud over there. It's freezing conditions, etc. The non-conditions, so we just call it ammonia. But anyways, if we open up our Bibles and to the book of Joshua, who was the first leader of the Jewish people, the chief of staff that led the Jewish people into the land of Israel on the 10th day of Nisan. He leads us into Israel after 40 years in the desert. And so it says in the chapter 18, verse 24, it says that Joshua gives to Benjamin the area, and he calls it the village of Amona. So we have here, okay, we have here Joshua, who represents love of the land of Israel, the first chief of staff that liberated the land of Israel from six hostile nations that had been living here for quite some time, not in their land, in our land. And so the place was given by Joshua, symbol of love of the land of Israel. He gives a place and he calls it Amona. And thousands of years later, check this out. You can't make this stuff up. On this same date that Amona is destroyed twice, if we look up in our code of Jewish law, in the chapter of 580, if we open up the Shulchan Aruch or Achaim, okay, the laws, the daily laws, if we open it up there, 580, we'll see that there's a list of dates during the year. Okay, when we're looking up in the Code of Jewish Law, 580, the daily laws, we see there's a list of dates during the year that if a person would like to, they are allowed to fast. These are days that terrible calamities hit the Jewish people. Various righteous people passed away. For example, coming up, we have on the seventh day of Adar, we have the day that Moses passed away. So that is, of course, a fast day. And in the month of Shvat, and on the fifth day, when they came twice to destroy Amona, 11-year difference. What happened on this day, the fifth day? An amazing fact. Amazing fact is that the 70 leaders of the Jewish Supreme Court, not to be mixed up with the not-so-Supreme Court of today. We're talking about in the times of Joshua, thousands of years ago. 70 of these leaders, judges, they were killed by God. Why were they killed by God? Because they did not eulogize Joshua, who had passed away. They did not eulogize him, such a righteous man, who brought us into the land of Israel and settled us into the land of Israel and conquered the land of Israel, showed us the way. He was not eulogized like he should have been, and therefore there was a tremendous punishment that 70 righteous men perished on the fifth day of Shvat. And it's an amazing thing. What does that mean? They did not eulogize, they did not appreciate Joshua like they should have. What happened on this date? Twice Amona is knocked off. The army, the government, the police, they come in and they throw people out of the land of Israel. An amazing thing. A lack of appreciation, of honor, of fear of the land of Israel. Joshua represented the land of Israel. You know, the Chiddush is an unbelievable Torah. Remember this one always. We know that there was a group of people that left Egypt 30 years before the Exodus. And it was part of some of the members of the tribe of Ephraim. Ephraim was one of the sons of Joseph. And they went out 30 years earlier because, according to their calculations, the time of redemption was here. So they leave, and on the way, when they come in towards the land of Israel, the border of the land of Israel, around the area of Gaza, they're wiped out by the Philistines. So listen to this Torah of Chida, never forget it. The Chida says, though they made a mistake in calculations, their motivation was a love of the land of Israel. And God never forgot that love of Israel that stemmed and caused them to leave the land of Israel and be murdered. And therefore, Hashem says, I remember your love of the land of Israel, children of Ephraim. I remember your love of Israel, though you made a mistake. People make mistakes, everyone makes mistakes. But your motivation was out of love of the land of Israel. I will make sure that the first leader that will liberate the land of Israel will be from your tribe, Ephraim. So Ephraim represents love of Israel. Joseph represents love of Israel, land of Israel. Where do we see that? We see in the beginning, the first page of Dvarim Rabbah, the Chazal, the rabbis, the sages ask a question. How come Moses' bones was not merit to come in the land of Israel? On the other hand, Joseph's bones did merit to come into the land of Israel. They're both righteous people. They should have had the same law. They should have been both allowed to come and be at least buried in the land of Israel. So the Chazal, the sages, tell us an unbelievable Torah. It says that the reason why Joseph merited to be buried in the land of Israel after the Jews escaped from Egypt was the fact that he acknowledged the land of Israel. Everywhere he went, he said, I'm from the land of Israel. If he was in Crown Heights, I'm not from Crown Heights. I'm from the land of Israel. I'm not from LA. I'm from the land of Israel. That's, according to the Zohar Kadosh, all Jews, all our souls are from the land of Israel. That's how we should feel. No matter where we are in the world, we really should feel that we're from the land of Israel. Moses, on the other hand, did not acknowledge the land of Israel. When he saved the girls, the daughters of Yitro, so they said, they came running into the house and all excited about what had happened, how Moses saved them from the evil shepherds that came to kill them. And they said, an Egyptian saved us. They're talking about Moses. And Moses kept quiet. He didn't say, I'm not an Egyptian. I'm from the land of Israel. Right? Rabbi Nachman of Breslov said, everywhere I go, I'm going to the land of Israel. We all have to feel that we are from the land of Israel, because that's really the truth. We are all from the land of Israel. So it's an amazing thing. On the fifth day of the month of Shvat, where some Jews fast, because of the fast that we didn't, the fact that the elders, the judges did not eulogize properly the representative of love of the land of Israel, of settling the land of Israel, of conquering the land of Israel, Joshua. And that day, the same day, twice, people that love the land of Israel, the residents of Amona, and the hundreds, or the thousand, or the 1,500 people that came to show support and to stand shoulder to shoulder and fight against the forces of evil. On the fifth day, where we did not have respect for the man that represents the land of Israel, same thing still is going on till this very day. Amazing thing. Recently, one of the leading rabbis in what they call the national religious yeshiva world, his name is Rav Tau. He used to be one of the, or the top rabbi in Merkaz Arav. There was a split some years ago, maybe 15 years ago. There was a split. Not important right now. Why? There was a split. Some stayed in the Merkaz Yeshiva, which is located in the Kiryat Moshe Jerusalem neighborhood, and some went with Rabbi Tau to Har Choma, which is a neighborhood not too far away from the old city. Rav Tau recently, about a month ago, spoke to a group of leading Rosh Yeshivas, leading rabbis of yeshivot, that their students go, they spend part of their time learning Torah and part of the time in the IDF, in the army. he gave a talk. It's an amazing talk. Let me just tell you, it's about, I have it, somebody gave it to me. It's about 8 pages long. It's worth your time to sit down and read it. When I read it, somebody gave it to me and said, Yehuda, you gotta read this. And I said, well, if he said that, there's some reason I have to read this. And he was right. This is, every Jew should read this. Let me tell you something. Rabbi Kahana had a great expression. He would be asked, what is the difference between you and somebody that seems to be very similar, a nationalistic, right wing, a hawk? And he would say, you know what? Very simply, he wouldn't start going into, you know what, I say on this issue, he says on that issue. No, very simple. The difference between me and him, or me and her, is 30 years or 20 years. Well, the difference between Rabbi Kahana and Rav Tau is about 30 years. Listen closely. Okay, I'm not going to read that 8 pages, but we are going to read a paragraph of his recent talk that he gave to the heads of the army yeshivot. He says the following. He was talking about one of the leading rabbis of the pre-army. In Israel, there's various institutions that kids, when they're in 10th grade or 11th grade, they come to these institutions that prepare you not only scholastically, but they also prepare you for the army. And you get special wages and special benefits and bonuses, etc. So they have these kinds of institutions. And there are many that are also religious, that before going into the army at 18, they give you a year or a year and a half of spiritual learning in order to strengthen you that you should be okay during the army. Because as we know, many people go into the army with their skull caps and they come out without them. They go in with their fringes, their tzitzit, and they come out of the army without them. So anyways, one of the leading rabbis of our times, his name is Rav Yigal Levinstein. And he recently caught the eye of all residents of Israel and probably all over the world. He gave a talk recently, a few months ago. Now, he also spoke about the army. Because once again, he leads the biggest yeshiva that prepares these students spiritually and also physically for the army. So he runs the biggest institution. Let's listen to what Rav Tal says. So Rav Tal talks about Rav Yigal Levinstein, and he says, why isn't he allowed to talk? See, now he's not allowed to speak anywhere. This Rabbi Yigal Levinstein from the army, from the yeshiva army, he's no longer allowed to speak at any base in the IDF, in the Israeli army. Not allowed to speak in any base. A person that's given his life for Torah and the IDF, preparing his students, probably thousands of them over the ages, and he's not allowed to speak. Why is that? What are they afraid of? So listen to this. The reason why they don't want to allow him to speak, because he devoured, he let us know the program of the uprooting of the religion, uprooting of Judaism that is taking place in many places within the army and other places in other government offices. Amazing thing. Rav Yigal Levinstein, they're afraid. They don't want to allow him to speak because he revealed to the public when he spoke some months ago. He revealed to the program, to the strategy. It's not by chance. In the army and other places, other government agencies, to uproot Judaism. Says the army has begun its program to take away Judaism from the Jew. And what Rav Yigal Levinstein publicized, listen to this, Rav Tao's writing, saying, what he publicized is not even half of what's the real story behind the uprooting of Judaism, of Torah, that's happening before our eyes, or actually not before everyone's eyes, in the army. Not even half. They're trying to stick girls into religious units, into all units. Many girls, after they're finished in the army, they're not built. They're not built, their body, they're different. They're not built for this military service, you know, tanks and all this kind of stuff. Many of them are suing the army because when they leave after 2 years that girls do military service, they're suing the army because now they can no longer have children and all other kinds of health problems. And that's why the army is doing they're putting on the steam, full steam ahead, to try to get religious girls into the army. Why is that? Why all of a sudden? It's all part of a program to destroy the Judaism of the Jew. Think about it. When the Jews came from North Africa 60 years ago, the same program, they were worried that the political clout of the religious community would overtake the secular. And therefore, they destroyed the Jews. They put them into irreligious, anti-religious institutions, moshavim, settlements, kibbutzim. They cut off their side curls, their peyot. What has changed? What has changed? So why are they doing this? Because they're afraid. Because they know that we have 10 children. Every family has 10 children. And therefore, they're trying to get the girls into the army. To get the girls into the army. So either they won't be religious, or they'll have trouble having children afterwards because they're being destroyed. They're trying to do the same hard work and labor that the boys are doing. Equality. The idea here is one, there's one goal here. The goal is to uproot religion. Not my words. The words of Rav Tao. They want to take the national religious camp and they want to make us barren. Empty. And he says this was the same reason why they destroyed 26 communities in Gush Katif, in Gaza Strip, and also northern Shomron. Why? There were no security issues here. Everybody knew that it was suicidal. So why did they go ahead? Why did they destroy what people had built for 40 years? Why did they destroy the lives of so many families? They destroyed it because they want to destroy the religious camp. And this was their way to destroy the religious camp by destroying their communities, the mikvahs and the shuls and the yeshivas that they built and the holiness of the communities. Because it didn't match their ideology. Now when you read this, how sad, how apathetic, disgusting. I saw about a week ago in Arut Sheva, who's supposed to represent the national religious community. I saw twice, two articles in Arut Sheva, not on the same day, different days, about there were massive demonstrations by the religious community against the Black Hat community. There were demonstrations in Jerusalem and Bnei Brak and other few places because a yeshiva student that did not want to enlist in the army and did not show up, he was arrested and placed in prison. So spontaneous demonstrations popped up all over the land of Israel. So what do we get in Arut Sheva? We get extremists. Got it? Extremists. 48 extremists arrested. Now, I don't understand. If you go out to fight for Amona, okay, are you also extremist? Or just if you disagree with going into the army, you're an extremist. But if you fight against the army, if you fight against the police, you know, you're a hero. That's the way it works. That's the way it works, eh? Extremists. 48 extremists. And then, not only that, they show you a picture. I'm sure it's not their picture, but you see a policeman with a religious demonstrator, like, you know, grabbing onto him, holding him. And you see blood dripping from his head. Now, we're all supposed to understand, you know, you're all supposed to understand that a demonstrator must have taken, you know, a bar, a metal bar, steel, a rock, and, you know, let him have it. Who says? The person that took the picture, he has an agenda. He has an agenda to make the religious community look bad. How do you know what happened there? Maybe, you know how many times I've seen this? That the cruel police or army running after girls or boys or poor souls, they fall, yes, and all of a sudden they get hit and there's blood dripping from their head. Why? Because they were about to beat the out of Jews and then they fell. So who knows? But you're supposed to make the association. Oh, see what the religious Jews did to this poor guy? Or perhaps, I've seen this many times, that their cruelty, the police or the army cruelty, so in order to defend yourself, in order to save your life or your arm from being broken, so you give them a smash in the face, and right, you did draw blood. But he was in self-defense. This is really disgusting. Arut Sheva. Listen to the words of Rav Tau. Rav Tau, can you imagine why they don't want to go into the army? I would advise Arut Sheva to publicize the article by Rav Tau. It's one of their boys. Yeah? One of ours. Listen to what he writes. He says that the army, it's a war. It's an uproot of the Judaism, of the religion, of the Torah. That's Rav Tau. And these people are extremists not to go into that army? They're trying to learn in yeshivas? They're extremists? An embarrassment for the national religious community. Amona, who's to blame? You might have read articles by good Jews who, of course, were not there. Doesn't mean that they're not good Jews. They are good Jews, but they were not there. They put the blame on the Supreme Court. Ah! We found the answer here. The Supreme Court. Is the Supreme Court to blame? Of course. Why is the Supreme Court to blame? We could spend a lot of time. I'm not going to waste my time on that. The Supreme Court in Israel is called the Bagatz. Beit Din Gavoa Letzedek. Supreme Court. If you do the numerical value of the Bagatz, it comes out to the same numerical value as Haman. Yeah, we're a few weeks, 3 weeks before Purim. Both of them are 95. Yeah, you could take your calculator and check it out. Bagatz, Bet Gimel Tzadi, and also Haman. So I'm not going to get into, okay, I'm not going to get into judicially, okay, why they are wrong. But we could do that very easily. It just takes a lot of time to do that. I'm not going to get into it. You know who we're talking about. Okay, so they're to blame, right? Of course they're to blame. But it's a partial answer. Okay, we got the real answer. The government, yeah, government. They promised, they said that if any settlement would be destroyed, they would leave the government. They did leave the government. They're still sitting on there in the government. Yeah, they're to blame. Oh, the people, asked the people of Amona, they promised us, the government, the officials, and they didn't keep their promise. Yeah, they're at fault. They're at fault? Of course they're at fault, but it's a partial fault. Okay, maybe we're warming up here. Maybe we're getting hotter. You know who? It's the settlement leaders. Yeah, settlement leaders. What have the settlement leaders been doing lately? They've been making deals on the land of Israel. You know, there used to be a great song by Mordechai ben David. Yerushalayim is not for sale. Voices crying. Remember that one, Lynn?
Classic.
Oh, classic. Yerushalayim. Jerusalem is not for sale. Well, we once thought that maybe the land of Israel is not for sale. But today, there's a sale going on of the land of Israel. And recently, in the last year or two, we've noticed that settlement leaders are making deals on the land of Israel. The government comes and said, listen, we're going to destroy this community. It happened in Beit El. It happened in Migron. It happened in Amona. We're going to destroy your communities, so let's make a deal. Yeah, remember that one? I mean, if the option was Carol Merrill, I mean, that's okay. Let's make a deal, Carol Merrill. Man, I saw that one passed you by. Let's make a deal. Where's Monty Hall? When you need him. But anyways, so they came to the government, came and they said, listen, we're going to destroy your community, so let's make a deal here. We're going to give you 200, 150, whatever the number is, apartments, homes, somewhere else. Somewhere over the rainbow. Yeah. Somewhere over the rainbow. Well, let me tell you folks, you can go to Beit El and you ain't gonna see those units, those homes built, because they ain't there. Ah, but the government promised? So they promised. You believe them? You could go to Migron and you ain't gonna see the new homes built. And you could go to Amona, where the residents made a deal. They made a deal, and you ain't gonna see them houses on the mountains. They're to blame. Those settlement leaders, they're always selling out the land of Israel. True, but it's a partial answer. Folks, for too long, we've been screaming, we've been yelling, we've been stamping our feet, we've been crying. There is a biblical commandment in the Torah to settle the land of Israel. But hand in hand with that side of the coin, just like a coin, every coin has two sides. The commandment to settle the land of Israel also has two sides. One is the physical settling the land of Israel. On the other hand, the second part, second side of the coin, is to expel the residents, the alien residents, the strangers, those that do not belong here, those that do not agree to accept sovereignty of the Jewish people, those that do not agree to accept and to perform the seven commandments of Noah, those that do not accept to have social rights but not political rights. Anybody that accepts those things, welcome to stay. Ahlan sa'alan, welcome, as we say. But all those others, they're not allowed. Out of here, expel them. So we have a commandment to settle the land of Israel, which includes settling the land of Israel, which means building homes, vineyards, orchards, trees, etc. But also it means expelling. And Hashem tells us that
if you do not expel the residents of the land of Israel, they will cause you tremendous tragedies, calamities,
destruction. As we see, every single day, there's not one day in Israel that there's a day of peace here. Every single day, there are rocks, there are Molotov cocktails, there are gunshots. Every single day, there are bombs. Most we don't even hear about. But there's not one day of peace here. As the Torah promised, that if you do not deliver by expelling, by doing the commandment of expelling the residents of the land of Israel, they will torment you on the land, your land, and they will eventually throw you out. And that is what we're seeing. So for too long, and it keeps on going on, the nightmare continues. We don't learn anything. It's always just settling. Let's build another house. They kill us. We say, build another settlement. Who's killing us? We gotta relate to those that are coming against the Jewish people for war, the Arab population. And we refuse to relate to this point. And therefore God tells us this is the result. We will be thrown out. Instead of them being thrown out, we're the ones that are being thrown out. Let me tell you about it. When I came to Israel, it was just my anniversary, 37 years, thank God, that I've been in the Holy Land of Israel. Got it, Land of Israel. Not the State of Israel. Holy Land of Israel. And since I've been here, let me tell you, there's a lot of places that I was, that I traveled, that I walked, that I lived, that are no longer, Jews are no longer allowed to go. In fact, if you go there, you could be arrested, baby. Where is Ramallah? Where is Shechem? Where is Jericho? Where is Beit Lechem? These are places that are Judenrein. Jews can't even walk in them. Forget living. So think about what's going on. We're blinded. We don't realize it. We are getting thrown out and we don't learn. We continue creating more settlements. We want to create. We're not creating. We're losing out the settlements. So instead, the Torah tells us what I wanted to do to them, i.e. expel them, I will do to you. So we lost Amona, we lost Beit El, we lost Migron, and the list goes on and on and on. Point number two of settling the land of Israel. It has to be the land of Israel. It has to be a next. It has to be us. It has to be part of Israel. Now, they're unbelievable. The leaders in the government waving the victory flag, you know? V, baby. What's the big victory? There's this law. It's called the regulation law. The regulation law. Chokas Dara. And oh, this is historical. This regulation law, man, it's historical. Yeah. Historical? Regulation law? Historical? Let me tell you the gewalt. Listen closely, open up your hearts. A few days ago in Los Angeles, City of Angels, Hollywood, there's a daily newspaper that comes out of U ra ra ra, C ra ra ra, L ra ra ra, A ra ra ra. Yeah. UCLA. There's a paper, it's called the Daily Bruin. Yeah, if you're a basketball or a football, you know the UCLA Bruins, yeah? And they had a cartoon in the Daily Bruin recently, about a week ago. And let me tell you about the cartoon. I can't show it to you, because my printer was not working today.
but I'll explain it to you. There's a cartoon that appeared, and you see a picture of the Prime Minister of Israel, caricature of him. And then you see two tablets, you know, like the Ten Commandments, like two tablets, call me in the morning. So you see the Ten Commandments in the back, and then you see number six. Number six, it says, thou shall not steal. And number seven, it says, thou shall not kill. Now, when you look in number six, where it says, thou shall not steal, the not is crossed out. So now it's, thou shall steal. You should steal, right? And then the caption of this cartoon is, Israel passes the regulation law which allows Israel to seize Arab land. Got it? Now, okay, so Israel passes a law, it's called the regulation law, which allows us to steal land of others. And of course the Bible says thou shall not steal. And here though, Israel is thou shall steal. We are stealing. The regulation law allows us to steal the land of the Arabs. Now, it says there, another caption in, next is number seven. Right? Got it? Number six is thou shall not steal. So what's after you broke that law and you're stealing from the Arabs their land, then number seven comes up. What's number seven? Okay, thou shall not kill. So that's the next one that we're going to do. Now we've stolen their land, and we've also, the next step is we're going to start killing them. Now, first of all, the funny part of this is that how dumb, what an idiot you have to be to put this cartoon together. Why? Because anybody with a half pea brain understands that if you look in the Ten Commandments, now the Ten Commandments are located in two different places. They're located in this week's portion, Jethro, and they're also in the end of they're at the beginning of Deuteronomy in the portion of the week of Etchanan. Now it doesn't matter whichever one you'd like to choose, but let me just tell you an interesting something we should notice. Right? This cartoon, number six, stealing, you should not steal. Number seven is, should not kill. Very interesting, idiots! Why? Because if you would have looked in a Bible, you would have seen the following. That number six is you should not kill. Number eight is you should not steal. Oh, bow, 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 yeah! You idiots! Dumkumpumps! Folks, think about it. The big victory. They're right. That cartoon, Jews protested. Jewish groups protested, and that cartoon was taken out of the Daily Bruin. But you could take it out of the Daily Bruin, but you can't take it out of the hearts of the masses. And in the hearts of the masses and the minds, this regulation law allows Jews to continue living in their settlements, which are, according to their view, stolen Arab land. This is the big victory of the right wing. Let's hear it for the right wing hawks. This is the victory that we are allowed, the world understands. It's not really ours, but we're allowed to steal lands of the Arabs for the purpose of Jewish settlements. We're allowed to do that. Instead of stopping these games, stop playing games, every single time, we're never hitting the hammer on, we're never hitting the nail on the head with the hammer. We're always sidetracked. When it comes to, we only take one issue of settling the land of Israel, building houses, and we sidetrack the importance of expelling, and we're trying to do our best to skip and ignore this question. What are we going to do with all these hostile enemies surrounding us? We ignore this, and we continue these games, and Jews are paying with their lives every day. And the same thing, playing regulation law. Wow, this is really something. That was a genius whoever came up with that law. We could go ahead and steal the law, the land of the Arabs. Great. Whatever happened, if it belongs to the Jewish people, it belongs, we annex it. It's part of the land of Israel. But here in Tapuach, and here in Elon Moreh, and in all the other settlements, we're not part of the land of Israel. We are not part. We are somewhere, you know, in space. Out of space here. We are not part of Israel. This is the end of part one. With God's help, next week we'll continue part two, the expulsion of Amona, warning, graphic.